Hi, Mark.
Congratulations.
Thank you. Okay, I think we're ready to start. First of all, I'll introduce the members of the Senate who are here, and if I miss anybody, please correct me. But to my left is the Senate President, Malcolm Smith, and we have Senator Chuck Fischillo. We have Senator Brian Foley, Senator Craig Johnson, and Senator Roy McDonald directly behind me. And I'll let Assemblyman Morelli introduce the Assemblymen who are here.
Good afternoon. Thank you. I'm delighted to be joined by, to my immediate right, Assemblymember Roanne Destito, Chairman of the Government and Operations Committee in the Assembly. To her right, Assemblyman Mark Schroeder, who is the Chair of the Subcommittee on Autism in the Assembly. Assemblymember Al Sturpee behind Mark. And those are the members from the Assembly that have joined us so far. Thank you.
Thank you, Joe. And I'd be remiss if I didn't identify to my right, Paige Pierce from Families Together, Judy Ursetti, from who's the regional director of the State Advocacy Relations and Autism Speaks, and a parent, and Dr. Brian Sheridan of the Academy of Pediatrics. And if I'm not missing anyone, this is a very happy day for a lot of people in this audience. I could look out and I know I'd miss people. I would be totally remiss if I didn't identify Kate Powers from my office, who worked assiduously on this. But, you know, I did find out very quickly that there's more than one point of view on autism, only too well. And it was really to craft a bill that really fit the needs of autism, while at the same time keeping healthcare costs within reason. And as you know, we have a bill today that doesn't have age limits, doesn't have caps, but we want something that is evidence-based. We want something that's politically necessary. And I think we've arrived at a wonderful bill that I think will have tremendous support throughout both houses. And without further ado, I'd like the President of the Senate, Malcolm Smith, to say a few words. And we've also been joined by my dear friend, Senator Shirley Huntley, to my left.
Thank you very much, Senator Breslin, to Senator Morelli and our colleagues in the Assembly and the Senate. This is a good day for the State Senate and for the state, notwithstanding the bill that we're talking about, but it's also Senator Breslin's birthday. So the present, because of Senator Breslin's ability to be so magnanimous, he has sought forward to bring forth an autism bill that, as we know, is critical to care for families with autism children. Insurance companies in the past have had practices that were obviously very subject to criticism and analysis. Senator Breslin and Senator Morelli and their leadership took on what we consider to be a very challenging issue. He has been working on this for quite some time. So it is with great pleasure that I stand here along with all of my colleagues in the State Senate. We're looking forward to moving this bill. Senator Breslin's leadership on this is without question. And for those who are curious as to the challenges that are before them, know that the insurance companies are now on notice that we are going to make sure that everyone has an opportunity for the proper coverage for care, which is critical to the state of New York. So Senator Breslin, Senator Morelli, congratulations to you.
Thank you. Thank you, Malcolm. And as one short digression, I never realized how traumatic it would be when you reach the age of 40. But having said that, I give you my dear friend, the chair of the Assembly Insurance Committee, Assemblyman Joe Morelli.
Good afternoon, thank you. And if you're 40, then I'm not quite 40,
right,
which is great news. I'm delighted to be here, and I want to thank Senator Breslin for all the hard work for he and his staff. I'd like to acknowledge the work of Justin Wilcox, who is my legislative director and has worked side by side with Kate Powers and the folks in the Senate. And I want to thank all of my colleagues who've worked so hard on an issue that is very emotionally charged. And I want to thank, however, first and foremost, the parents and families who have been touched by the disorder and who are working day in and day out, not only to take care of their children and their families, but providing great advocacy on the part of all parents and all families around the state who may not be in a position to be able to participate in this discussion. This is vitally important. And I was touched indirectly. My chief of staff had a son who was diagnosed 4 years ago with autism. And so I have seen the toll that this takes on families that that struggle to make sense of this and to provide all the services they can for their children. And this is an important day. I don't think, although there are times when people want legislative solutions to be all-encompassing and do everything, and we have a long way to go, but this is a very, very important, very significant step in the direction of providing families and children with quality services that they need to be able to continue to add to the state's significant efforts in this regard. So I want to again thank all of my colleagues, and as I said, this is emotionally charged. We have done, as Neil rightly points out, I think try to strike the appropriate balance between the needs of children and families by continuing to maintain a very, very important eye on the cost of health insurance to provide comprehensive care and to remove the barriers, most importantly, that many families have faced relative to insurance coverage when it comes to habilitative services, when it comes to speech therapy, when it comes to occupational therapy and physical therapy, and all the things that go a great deal to helping these children and their families. And so this is a very, very important day. We've got a lot of work to do in the future, but I think today is a day when we pause to celebrate the great work that all of you have done, all the advocates, all of the legislators, all the people who have been involved. So thank you very much, Neil, and all my colleagues for helping us arrive at this day.
Thank you, Joe. Now, next, I'm going to bring a threesome up. If they don't know they're coming up as a threesome. And that's the Long Island delegation that's here, who have done just an exceptionally good job. As you know, autism speaks, and it speaks very loudly on Long Island. And Senator Chuck Fischillo, Senator Craig Johnson, Senator Brian Foley, and I'd like to have Senator Craig Fischillo say a few words, who was so instrumental in allowing different groups to come together, including Democrats and Republicans.
On your birthday. And who says it doesn't work, the system up here between Republicans and Democrats? But let me thank Senator Breslin for his leadership. It wasn't too long ago that myself and Senator Craig Johnson and Assemblyman Harvey Wiesenberg were standing in the driveway of a resident in my community, Michael G. Gongorio's house, with the supporters and leaders of Autism Speaks, and we learned firsthand about the financial perils that families go through and how they have to refinance their house and take out second and third mortgages and home equity loans to provide the proper care that they deserve for their children. And today is the step in the right direction that ends the decision families have to make throughout New York State on whether they go broke or they provide the necessary care for their children. Today is a tremendous step in the right direction. I applaud the Senate for their actions. This is the right thing to do. It should have been done a long time ago. We're going to do it today, and the Assembly is going to follow, and I want to thank Assemblyman Morelli for his leadership as well. So, Senator Breslin, to you and your staff, thank you very much for your leadership. It was great to work with you. I knew we'd get it done. I knew we'd get it done before you turned 41 years old. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Jack. And one person who's absent who had a great deal to do with this is Senator Tom DeWayne, the chairman of the Health Committee in the Senate, who was there every step of the way. And as you know, when you deal with him, you deal with someone who's extremely bright on the issue. So I'd like Assemblyman Morelli to introduce a member of the Assembly.
Yeah, I again want to thank, obviously, the leadership in our House, Speaker Silver, who was so supportive of our efforts and is a co-prime sponsor of this bill, and he had the great wisdom to select Mark Schroeder to head the subcommittee on autism in the Assembly, and it's my great pleasure and privilege to introduce Assembly Member and Chairman of our subcommittee on autism, Mark Schroeder.
Thank you. Thanks, Joe. Good afternoon, and it's a pleasure for me to be here with my partners in government. And as Assemblyman Morelli stated, to the Speaker's credit, in May of 2008, he saw the need to create off of the Mental Health Committee a subcommittee on autism and selected me as the chair, which I'm proud to be here with you. And I have met with hundreds of families with autism, and each case and each story, as you know, is very, very different. Also, within the Autism Committee, there are four assembly members who are on the committee, but I did initiate a rather unorthodox approach 2 years ago and created a Western New York Autism Committee with professionals, doctors, parents, advocates, about 25 people. We've had meetings almost weekly during the summer and fall months. The emails are going all over the place, as you can imagine, especially when some legislation stirs up the cosmic dust. And originally, that's exactly what the Morelli-Breslin bill did. And many of the Autism Committee members on my committee preferred different autism bills. But I realized right from the beginning, my instinct was that the Breslin-Morelli bill was moving, and to their credit, Joe Morelli and Neil Breslin, they listened to everybody. They listened to others, and they amended the bill, and to me, this is a great start. And so to Senator Breslin and Assemblyman Morelli and their staff, they talked with my group, and I also won't forget December 22nd, 2008, when Assemblyman Morelli and myself had an insurance autism public hearing here in Albany, started at 9 a.m. and did not end until like 7 p.m. And Joe Morelli stayed the whole time listening to parents and to advocates. Some of the highlights in the amended bill, the AAP guidelines have been taken out. Section 1, line 5 of the bill, shall not exclude. And if that wasn't good enough, it comes back again in lines 9, 10, 11, very specific, says, shall not exclude coverage for the treatment of medical conditions otherwise covered by the policy because the individual is diagnosed with autism spectrum disorder. Lastly, people can't be denied without an opportunity for an external appeal as opposed to just grieving it. And so finally, not only do I have the pleasure of being on the Insurance Committee and the Chair of Autism, but I'm also on the Oversight Committee of the Assembly, and I will be presenting the Breslin-Morelli bill to Chairwoman Titus, and especially having to do with Section 1B, lines 4 through 8, in terms of the three commissioners who have some responsibility to this and in 12 months need to update regulations. And so we'll be watching it, and I'm proud to be with my colleagues here today. Thank you.
Thank you, Mark. And as Mark indicated, it was a work in progress up to the end, listening to all sides. And now with the advocates, we have Judith Hersetti, who's the Regional Director of the State Advocacy Relations for Autism Speaks. Judith.
Thank you, Senator Breslin. Such an honor to be here. I am Judith Hersetti. I'm Regional Director of State Advocacy Relations from Autism Speaks. But more importantly, I'm here as the mother of a beautiful, almost seven-year-old with autism spectrum disorder. His name is Jack. 5 years ago, I walked out of my pediatrician's office with an autism diagnosis for my then two-year-old. I had in my hands several prescriptions for care for my son, for evidence-based care that would possibly allow him to speak and function, maybe one day have a job or a friend. It would open the doors to communication for him. And I walked out of the doctor's office that day thinking, well, first of all, I was shocked with the diagnosis, of course. And I remember thinking, wow, this is really going to be a hassle. I'm going to be on the phone making appointments. I anticipated wait lists. Never for a moment did I anticipate that health insurers would deny the treatment that my doctor prescribed for my son. What I learned very quickly was that not one treatment, but all of the treatments my doctor prescribed were denied. Whenever I talked with a health plan, the immediate knee-jerk response was denied. And over the years, over the last 5 years, I've met with parents all over New York and all over this country who have had the same experience. It's rare that families are able to access coverage for their children and adults who have autism. And I knew then that something had to change, and so that's where the mission began. 5 years ago as well, an organization was founded right here in New York State by the name of Autism Speaks. And when Autism Speaks was formed, they formed a government relations department, and we talked with families all over the country, and we asked them, what is the most pressing issue? What do we need to work on? And without exception, the answer was health insurance coverage. People with autism are denied, they're excluded. And so we've been working. 5 years ago, if you looked at the map of the United States, there were two states that had legislation on the books requiring health insurers to cover autism treatment. Two. Now here we are 5 years later, we have 20 states that have passed legislation requiring health insurers to cover autism treatment, and we're thrilled to see that happen. But the one state that I think is most critical to this effort is the state I'm standing in right now, where Autism Speaks is headquartered, where so many health plans are based. New York, you lead the country, and you also affect my health insurance and my son with autism. So I'm thrilled that after almost 2 years since that hearing that we sat through in December, and we heard from families from New York who are struggling, and through all the dialogue and all the hearings and all the votes and the amendments and the conversations and the emails and phone calls, that we finally, because of the leadership of Senator Neil Breslin and the leadership of Assemblymember Morelli, we are finally here today, poised to see passage in the Senate and eventually, I know, in the Assembly as well. Their leadership and their patience, the education that they've opened themselves up to about our community and the needs has just been second to none, and I can't thank them enough for that. So I celebrate with you today, and I want you to know that this truly does make a difference. The evidence-based treatments that we're advocating for can change a person's life. My little boy Jack, who I told you about at the beginning of my thoughts here, it's been 5 years since he was diagnosed with autism. He was diagnosed at the severe end of the spectrum. And until about 6 months ago, he was considered to be a nonverbal individual. But I'm so thrilled to tell you that he's talking to us. After thousands of dollars and much therapy and a lot of hard work on his part and the wonderful therapists that work with him, he's talking to us. One of the first sentences he said, he stomped into my kitchen and said, I want dinner. And my husband and I looked at each other, we couldn't believe it. So the doors of communication are open to him, and the sky is the limit. So thank you. Thank you for opening those doors for the families of New York.
I think we made a mistake. I think we should have had Judith go first. And next, Dr. Brian Sheridan from the Academy of Pediatrics in District 2.
Thank you very much, and thank you for having me here today. I think this is a great day. I kind of see autism on the other end of the spectrum, and I don't mean the autism spectrum, but as a physician. Nobody in my family has autism. But in my pediatric family, I have several patients with autism. I think you can break down the autism, and like this bill appropriately does, into three parts that families go through. The first is screening, the second is diagnosis, and then the third is the treatment. The screening process is something that 100% of children in New York State should go through. We in our office right now do screen 100% of the patients that come through our office at 18 months and 24 months of age. And that's based on the guidelines recommended to us from the American Academy of Pediatrics. They have a really interesting program called Bright Futures, and in that program, they really say educating families and screening at 18 months and 24 months of age can help diagnose autism. We instituted this about a year ago, and since then, I've had two children myself come into my office who ultimately were diagnosed with autism based on an 18-month screen. And that was a big surprise to the family and also a big surprise to me. Currently, of the 100% of the children that we screen, only about 50% of those insurance companies will actually pay for that simple screening tool that takes all but a few minutes. So now it would be nice to see 100% coverage for that simple screening tool, because who knows what we're missing. And I think the moment we screen in our office because it's the right thing to do, the more we can educate other pediatricians to do the same thing, you'll see a benefit. And I think this legislation helps to do that. The second is diagnosing. The screening tool is just that. It's a screening tool. More efforts are going into the diagnosing of autism on a regular basis, and the diagnosis has certainly changed, as I'm sure everyone here is aware, over the last few decades. The average age of diagnosing a child with autism is somewhere around the age of 4 or 5, and if you talk to families whose children have autism, you'll find that's way too late. We can do this much sooner. It should be 18 months, if not 24 months of age. And that should be 100% of our children with autism should be diagnosed at that. And that's not the case across the country. I think certain parts of the country do better, and I'm sure New York State will be able to do better with that because of legislation such as this. And the third part is treatment. I think the American Academy of Pediatrics, and I know I'm partly to blame for that, I think we've done a very poor job of saying that autism is a treatable condition. Many people think when you're diagnosed with autism, that's it. I'm not saying you can be cured from autism. What I'm saying is we can treat this. This is no different than someone who has heart disease or high blood pressure. Once you're diagnosed with that, you're going to have high blood pressure, you're going to have heart disease. We can treat that, we can treat the same with autism. And the finances to do it really need to be in place in order for us to do that successfully. So. Thanks to everybody standing behind me today, and I think this is a great day for New York State. Thanks.
Thank you, Dr. Sheridan. And right behind me is Senator Roy McDonald, who has two grandchildren who are autistic. Senator McDonald.
Thank you, Senator Breslin. Thank you for your hard work. Thank you, Assemblyman. Thank all of you. And as Senator Breslin said, this is more than just an issue for me that's politically. I'm here as a grandfather as much as a senator, maybe more. And I know that's the same feelings of all the members of the Assembly and all the members of the Senate. This is an issue that, as it was mentioned by Senator Breslin, is nonpartisan. This is the love for the people in our state that need the love the most. So I am so proud to be a part of our Senate and our Assembly today addressing these issues. I know there's a lot of work to be had. I see it every day when my 5-year-old and 7-year-old grandsons, Jacob and David. It's not easy. I was listening to the comments that you made in reference to the different hurdles that you go through. My guys don't talk. I wonder if they're going to be a politician. Who knows? They don't talk, and it's a very serious thing. You don't know what's going through their mind, and we have problems if they're sick, if they're crying, whatever it is. So knowing that the state of New York is doing what it's doing and the compassion that it's shown through our leaders here, I'm grateful to be a part of that. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Well, I think just about everyone has spoken. For all of the advocates here, pat yourselves in the back. It was really, really a team effort that I have not seen in my many years here. So. With that, we'd be glad to answer any questions that you might have. Yeah. It's coincidental that went on when we asked her questions. Yes, James. Thank you very much.
Yes.
Absolutely.
And talk a little bit about how you see this affecting families. So Senator Fischel will talk about families who have second mortgages, who are going broke because they can't pay for the treatments, but the insurers are not covering it. How will this affect families on a daily basis?
I can only imagine that when you get down, if you have an autistic child, and that you, without this bill, where you would make a decision between paying a mortgage, the food you eat, what you do during a particular week, and the treatment of your child. And it would seem to me that in 99% of the cases, you're going to choose your child. But in many cases, that's an enormous sacrifice, one that people should not have to endure. Well, I'll address the second question first. The insurance department has looked at that, and they've said that it would be no more than a 2% increase in premiums. There's been evidence in other states, South Carolina, I believe one of them, where they had estimated in that area, and it's been less than 1%. So it's expensive, but not in comparison to what a lot of people have predicted. And I believe that we can keep it in the 1% area. In terms of total numbers, I defer to...
Well, you see, diagnoses are, depending on which study you look at, but 1 in 100.
1 in 100, yeah.
Children being born with somewhere on the autism spectrum. So, you know, it's obviously significant in the tens of thousands of young people annually, and obviously their families are affected. So this is significant.
James.
When you and I talk about this,
I know they keep asking you all these questions.
I play a doctor and told
her. When I talked to both of you, I mentioned to you that at that point, the Association of Counties was concerned about some of the language in the bill, that it would create a loophole that insurers would use to not pay for treatments that are provided by counties through educational programs in schools.
That loophole was corrected. The counties are very satisfied that they will not incur any additional costs over and beyond the costs they now incur. I would have every expectation and hope that the governor would sign it. It's a piece of legislation that I think is landmark. I think he'll be happy to sign it, but I don't ever say that I'm speaking on behalf of the governor.
Premium increases limited just to policies that family plans or across the board?
That would be across the board.
Some women, do you know the bill number in the assembly?
No, you got to ask me a question like that? I have no idea.
7,000.
I barely know what district number I represent.
I think it's 1370A.
We know what the bill says. We don't know what the number is, but we'll get it for you.
Where's that at in the assembly right now?
It's been reported out of the assembly insurance committee, and it is currently in the assembly ways and means.
Do you expect any problems in that?
Well, I never speak for my colleagues, but it has broad support, I'm hopeful that we'll be able to report out of Ways and Means, Rules, and then to the floor within the next several days. I'm hoping for action next week, possibly on the floor.
It is on the Ways and Means calendar for Thursday.
That would be
true.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We assume that it is, yes. If you say so. James.
As you know, this is a somewhat controversial issue, and people have different views on it. Your bill, I believe, does not spell out specifically which treatments would be covered and which ones would be excluded. Why did you take that approach versus, as you know, some autism groups want you to spell out every single treatment in the bill?
I think it's because autism, in the whole scheme of things, is a relatively new disorder with a lot of treatments on an ongoing basis. And to identify treatments in a statute, to me, would make it obsolete within a short period of time. This is a flowing statute where there will be a review on a periodic basis to determine what new treatments are acceptable, evidence-based, clinically proven, and maybe at the same time take others out that they've shown not to be acceptable.
And that's consistent with other provisions that relate to insurance law, where we don't get into identifying which diagnostic tests under which circumstances, which types of screening, what type of treatment protocols, because medicine and rehabilitation and habilitation are dynamic, so we want to make sure that this changes and different treatment modalities will be acceptable as the science continues to improve.
Having said that, I know when we talk about cost, and I think Judith and Paige would agree that the early intervention part of it, we're very hopeful that that's going to reduce costs. We're going to have great success at an early age, yes, where it might have been denied in the past because lack of coverage, which later
costs the taxpayer a great deal more. Thank you very much. Yeah, have a great day.